So both these we have tried doing in the class. So you prepare yourself for one bar graph and one histogram. If it is coming, you should know how to represent the given data in the form of a histogram or a bar graph. The third one that we did was given an information in the form of fractions. You know how to put it in the form of a pie chart. This also we have done. A tabulation will be given. You can turn to page number 78 and 79. You can come to 81 also. 81. You see the tabulation is given there. Are you looking at your textbook? This is in page number 80, where you have one question given on a particular day. The sales of different items in a bakery are given in the form of 320, 80, 160, 120, and 40. Represent this data in the form of a pie chart. So first of all, you should know what is the total of all the items, the different items in the bakery, that is 320 plus 120 plus 160 plus 80 plus 40. That comes out to be 720. So what fraction of the total quantity of substances or the items in the bakery is the bread? Bread is 320 out of 720. So we convert first the quantity of an item in the form of a fraction. So just like that, the biscuits will be 120 divided by 720. Cakes and pastries will be 160 divided by 720, so on. So the first column that you are going to create is the fractions. The second column, you will create the central angle, because when you prepare a pie chart, every portion of that circle which is getting divided to frame the pie chart. What is a pie chart actually? It is a circular graph where you divide a given circle into various portions, dividing means depending on what is the portion for a particular item. Now you know ordinary bread is 320. 320 rupees it is sold out of 720. So the fraction was 4 by 9. So 4 by 9 of 360, because in a complete circle, the total angle is 360. You will be writing it like this. See, once I am showing you the pie chart again, because this is quite probable you will get one pie chart again. The item sales in rupees, this is the problem given to you. The sales in rupees for items in a bakery, that is the bread, biscuits, then the cakes, fruit bread, and others. So the information given on the various items, the sales in rupees is given as 320, 120, 50 for the cakes, 160 for the cakes, 80 and 40. The total sales for all these items we have to first find out, that comes out to be 720. So this information has to be put in the form of a pie chart. So you have the first column that you have to make. This is the problem given to you. The next column that you have to create is that of the fraction. What fraction of the complete circle will be your bread is what is given.
320 divided by 720.
So what fraction of this entire 720 is going to be your bread? It is 320 by 720. So the first fraction you have to find out. Alright? So once the fractions are ready, any problem, whatever be the problem, first find the total of all the quantities given, then find out the individual fraction of each item. This is how you will do it. Once the fraction is ready, then you have to find in the complete circle, what should be the angle to get this fraction? So the next one, the column that you make will be the central angle. I think this video I have shared with you, the class itself. You can see that also once again. So the central angle will be decided based on this. So this will be reduced to 4 by 9. I hope you understand how it is 4 by 9. 4 are multiples of 8, 8 4s are 32, 8 9s are 72. Now 4 by 9 is the fraction of the circle that you have to make to represent the bread. The sales of bread will be represented as 4/9 of the entire circle. So when I want to divide 4/9 of the entire circle, I know the entire circle makes an angle of 360 degrees. So what should be the angle in the center to divide 4/9 of the complete circle will be given as 4/9 of the total angle, which is 360. This is 40 times, so your central angle should be 160 degrees. Idagmela, I hope you know how to plot it on the circle. You draw a circle. Should I do it or you know how to do it? So this is eligible for a 4-mark question. You will draw the circle neatly using your compass. Then you will mark the center, draw the radius. The first portion is telling it is that the sales of bread, which is having an angle at the center as 160. So you will keep your protractor here. Measure this is 90, somewhere 120, this must be 160. So this portion will be the sales of bread. Like this, for each of the sales of the different items, you will find out the central angle and continue dividing the circle into smaller sectors or smaller portions. So this representation of a circle into smaller sectors is called a pie chart, a circular chart. Alright, so this you can expect for a section B, which is a 4 marks, because only the tabulation will be given till here. You should create the fraction and then the central angle, then go and complete the pie chart. Here, so then the 3 marks question, because this chapter has got a 3 marks and a 4 marks. The 3 marks question probably should be from the histogram and the polygon that we have drawn. So you can see, look at page number 76 in exercise 5.1. There are some data given to you, like the shoppers who come to a departmental stores are marked as man, woman, and boy and girl. The following list gives the shoppers who came during the first 4 hours in the morning. Make a frequency distribution table using the tally marks. You know how to put the tally marks and prepare the frequency distribution table. You will be asked to draw a bar graph for that. This is one variety. Or like you are given the weekly wages of some persons there, you are going to group that into group frequency distribution. Because when you take the class intervals, so if you just give the name, like the previous problem, it was man, woman, boy and girl. There is no group distribution there. When do you tell it is a group distribution? When there are class intervals. Class intervals, that is between 10 and 20, 20 and 30, 30 and 40. So you are grouping them into smaller sections. That will lead to a group distribution. Right? So when group distribution has to be put in the form of a graph, what we will get will be a histogram. Because the bars will not be separated. They will be continuous. 0 to 10 if there are 5 people who are scoring there. Between 10 and 20, there will be another 6 people. So the bars will become attached because your class intervals will be continuously marked on the x-axis. Like this. I hope you are understanding. I am doing it fast because it is just a revision. This is done in the class already. I don't know if you attended those classes. Yes.
Tell me. Ma'am, we have to take upper class limit or lower class limit?
You can take either of them, but you should uniformly maintain the same. Till all your tally marks are taken, please maintain. If you have started with the lower limit, you should end the last entry also with the lower limit. If you start with the upper limit, you should end the last entry also with the upper limit only. You fix your rule whether you want to take it as an upper limit or a lower limit. I know in your textbook it is said that it should be the upper limit. It is not a rule like that. It is just a convenience factor, but it should be uniformly done till the last entry is taken. When you put the tally marks, you must be very careful about that. If you start with lower limit, the last entry also you should end with a lower limit only. If you start with an upper limit, then definitely you should end with the upper limit only. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes,
ma'am. So this is your x-axis and this is your y-axis. When you have the class intervals specified in your group data, Suppose if it is 0 to 10, 10 to 20, because you will be marking your x-axis like this, between 0 and 10, if you have 4 entries, your first bar will come like this. And between 10 and 20, if you have 8 entries, your second one will come like this. So can you see the bars are getting attached to each other? So when you make a grouped distribution in the form of a graph, what you will get will be a histogram. So either you may get a bar graph or you may get a histogram for a 3 marks question. So you must be ready to represent the graph as a histogram or a bar graph, depending on what kind of distribution you are going to get. Clear? So this is all that you have to prepare for in your data handling. Right? Now moving on to the next one was visualizing solids. Now in visualizing solids, you have questions in the 1 mark also. Just get back to your blueprint. I'm reading it from there. In the visualizing solids, you have one in section A, one in section B, and two in section C. Alright, two in section C. So section C you can understand because we are going to draw, we were used to drawing the map for a given context or a given layout. Means if you are in the class, how will your classroom, means you want to draw the map of a classroom to explain to somebody how it looks like. How will you represent it in a two-dimensional form? Because you'll be drawing it on the paper. So these things we have done. We have taken it as some activity also and done. So you should be able to draw the map of a particular situation given to you. Maybe if you are asked to draw a roadmap of the distance or the way you travel from your school to your house or from your house to your school with the landmarks taken care of. Because you are traveling every day between them, you know how to maintain the landmarks. And when you draw a map, you should also be aware that you have to keep in mind the scale. Scaling is very important in a map because if there are two landmarks which are farther away, you have to show it with a longer distance. And if there are two landmarks, suppose the school, there is a shop, there is a hospital, and then it's your house. So if the distance between the shop and the hospital is smaller than the distance between the hospital and your house, you have to proportionately show it in your map also. It is not that somewhere you put the hospital, somewhere you put the shop and tell that this is how I draw the map for the route map. No. Always the scale in the map is very important. So you will tell, if I show it as 1 centimeter in my map, it is equal to some 5 kilometers in the actual manner as it is. So that scaling you have to take care. This may come. You may be asked to draw a route map. Or you may be asked to read a map and tell what is the information you could get from that. So both these are there in your page number 163 in exercise 10.3. Are you looking at that? Then you had also studied the different views of objects. So this is a question which is probable in the 2 marks. You will be given an object. You may be asked to draw its side view, top view, what means the side view, the front view, or the top view. So you should be able to imagine how the object would look when it is looked at from the top or when it is viewed from the front. So all this I think you can practice in that exercise itself in page number 158 and 159. All right, so that is a 2 marks question. 3 marks I told you may be asked to read a map or draw a map, both are possible. Then we have 2 questions actually in 3 marks. So Euler's formula is one more very important thing that we have verified in that chapter. So given a solid, you should know how to verify the Euler's formula. What is the Euler's formula? Can you recall? What does the Euler's formula say?
F plus V minus E is equal to 2.
Huh. That means what is this F, V and E in that formula?
Faces, vertices and edges.
Yes, it is the number of faces, vertices and edges. Alright, so given any solid, you should be able to identify how many faces, how many vertices and how many edges that has got. So adu nimge gottidre you can verify the Euler's formula. It should hold good for any regular polygon. This Euler's formula will definitely hold good. So you should be in a position, suppose the image of a certain solid is given to you, using that you should be able to find out what is S, what is V and what is E. Once you get these three, you will be applying it in the Euler's formula to tell LHS has become equal to RHS. Then you have verified. So this is also a probable 3 marks question in the question bank. All right, so that was it for the visualizing of solids. Actually, that faces, edges and vertices, there are lots of scope of asking questions. Any solid given, you should be able to identify what kind of solid it is, because polyhedrons are of different varieties. We have studied about prisms, we have studied about pyramids, we have studied about convex polygons, we have studied about concave polygons. So just quickly go through all the information which is there in your textbook. Should be helpful in the 1 mark, because there are questions in 1 mark also from this chapter. That's why it is given for the 1 mark. Clear? Okay. Now, I don't know whether we are in a position to meet again on Friday, because Friday we have this work of seating arrangement in the school. So I'm not very sure whether we have a chance to meet back again. So I think quickly I'll go through the remaining chapters which we have not taken up for revision so far. Can we go back and see which are those chapters we have not yet gone through?
Ma'am, comparing quantities, squares and square roots.
Comparing quantities, I think sir has done. No, I have not done it, my dear. I
yes,
think
ma'am, sir
would have
did
told
it.
You about it. Squares and square roots, yes, I can tell you. I thought comparing quantities, he would have told you what he has given.
Have done it, ma'am.
Yes?
He have done it, ma'am.
Okay, okay then. I think I won't go back to comparing quantities then. The squares and square roots, you have 1 and 1 mark and 1 and 2 marks. That is very obvious. Anyway, square roots, to find out square roots, we have one problem. It can be a decimal or it can be an ordinary number. We have two methods that we have learned. That is the prime factorization method as well as the division method. So both those methods you have to be good at to score this marks in the section B. Section 1, I think we had a long discussion on the properties of square numbers. I have shown it as slides also to you. Get back to that video. That will be a very useful link for you to prepare, because all the properties of square numbers I have discussed in length there. So please go through that. Or otherwise, if you don't have an access to the video, you can go through your textbook. The textbook itself is very well explained. There are all the properties are beautifully explained there. So that will help you score that 1 mark in the squares and square roots. Then is there any other chapter that I have not touched yet? I think I have done most of them. Mensuration also we have completed, is it not?
Yes.
Okay, what about exponents and powers? Did we discuss? Yeah, I think we discussed. I told you which is a probable 4 marks question, which can be a 2 marks and which can be a 1 mark. All the laws of exponents that we have, please be thorough with them. Any of them can be asked in the 1 mark. 2 marks, I told you the simpler problems where you have less number of laws which are applied, that will come in the 2 marks. If the question is having more than 2 or 3 laws of exponents which are used, such a problem is eligible for a 4 marks. Yes? Yeah, anything else that you want to ask me, please quickly ask me. I don't know. We are not certain whether we are meeting back on Friday. So anything else regarding the preparation for the exam or any other doubt in any other chapter, any clarification on the blueprint, please do ask. I think I have another 5 minutes easily. Should I stop the recording or should I wait till your queries are over?
Then we can stop now.
Okay, I'll stop.